And howdy varmints! In this video, we'll be using spiral prismatic packing in a spirit run for the first time, and we'll review 3 days of distilling and tasting notes. Welcome to Open Source Distilling, where time-honored tradition meets modern-day technology. This channel is dedicated to challenging and modernizing home distilling traditions in an apartment setting. If that's something that you're interested in, hit that subscribe button and that bell icon so you don't miss any future videos. So, step one on any distilling day for me is getting ready, setting up the still itself. So I'll throw some pieces of cork down on the ground and grab my still from the closet. We'll be using about 6 gallons of 35% low wines from our stripping run video, linked in the doobly-doo down below. So let's start siphoning those low wines into the boiler, and we'll get our Triac power controller hooked up. My power controller is hooked up to a ground fault interrupter circuit, and those circuits are designed to save human life instead of the life of the appliance. So if you're doing electric distilling, by all means, safety first, you got to get one of these special circuit breakers. My circuit breaker is a 30 amp hot tub breaker, so designed for an actual hot tub, obviously, and that's hooked up to an element that runs at about 3,125 watts at full power. Once the low wines are in the boiler, I'll top it up to about the 10 gallon mark on my keg. Now, I've got like a few rings in my keg, and the 10 gallon mark is at the bottom of the topmost ring. Now, these rings, they show as indents when you're looking in the inside of the keg. So I'm getting in there, getting down low, got my flashlight in there, and one day I'm going to add a sight glass to my boiler so I don't have to do this. I can just fill up, look at the sight glass, know exactly how much volume is in the boiler at all times. Next is the reflux column. This run we'll be using spiral prismatic packing for the very first time. If you'd like to see the unboxing and cleaning of the spiral prismatic packing, link down below in the description. I use a pipe level when setting up my column to ensure that I get it absolutely vertical. And I use the highly technical technique of shimmying it with old vice magazines. So vice, if you're listening, your magazine without nudity is bad enough to gag a maggot. Man, just get your house together. Now, I use a dual probe ThermaQ temperature gauge. It's got two K-type thermocouples on it and it has min-max alarms. This thing's pretty awesome. I use it for homebrew a lot. Means I can set some alarms up and I don't have to sit there and babysit the still and watch it every second of the distilling process. One of the probes is attached to the top of the still to monitor the vapor temperature. The other probe is set up to monitor the cooling water exiting the still. So when I'm distilling, I want to keep that water exiting the still somewhere in the range of like 50 to 60 Celsius. And you don't want to cool the distillate too much. What you want to do is cool it just enough that it becomes liquid, so when it heads down that reflux column, it can get vaporized once again and be redistilled. If you cool that reflux too much, it's going to basically waste the very top of your column, and that liquid's going to have to go further down the column to get revaporized. I have my water feeding into a 4 ounce glass taster cup from a spirit festival, beer festival, whatever it was. And then I put the probe into that taster glass. Now, it may kind of be hard to see from this video, but that's what's going on. In this picture, you can see that I hooked up a hose clamp to control, basically do a finer control than what I can with just the tap. So even a small difference in water flow can greatly affect the temperature of that water coming out of the still. Now, I did make some adjustments throughout my 3 days of distilling, and I started off with a hose, just like a regular hose clamp, and then I ended up wrapping the hose in vinyl tape and then putting the hose clamp over that. So that was just to like prevent some pinching of the hose and all that. And then I ended up having a hose clamp with kind of like a wing nut on it, where you didn't need a screwdriver to adjust it. You could just use your fingers and twist that wing nut. Now, this isn't like the most elegant solution. I do have a couple needle valves kicking around, so we're going to give those a try next time. At the beginning of the run, I spent about 3 hours just playing with the power settings. So doing some research on the internet, it appears that spiral prismatic packing, or SPP, likes to be flooded a little bit, and that's when it performs the best. When light flooding happens, you get liquid holdup at the top and the bottom of the column, and that's when you get the lowest HETP, meaning that you get the most theoretical plates in the column when you achieve that. I spent about 3 hours playing with power settings, trying to find out that sweet spot where I had the column flooding just like a little bit, but not flooding completely. It's hard to really tell without a sight glass what's going on inside of the column. And in my newer still, my automated still that I'll be building in the future, I definitely will have a sight glass at the top so we can see the liquid hold up at the top and adjust the power setting based on that. I didn't keep fantastic notes on my first day. What I really wanted to do was try and run it like I did with the stainless steel scrubbies I've used my entire life. So that's exactly what I did. I kind of run it slow. After playing with the power for a very long time, I ended up settling on 1,000 watts for the entire run. And the first thing I do is let the column reach equilibrium. And I think I let it sit for maybe an hour and a half. And then I open up the needle valve completely. And I collect as much liquid as I can in my 50 mil graduated cylinder. And I time how long it takes to fill that graduated cylinder up. And that is my zero reflux ratio reading there. And that's used to calculate the reflux ratio moving forward during the run. So I do take a zero reflux reading usually at the beginning and partway through the runs usually. Now I didn't in this first run, but in the second and third runs, I ended up doing that. Well, after a full day of distilling, I did collect a 55% yield on this very first run, and in my opinion, that's not too bad. I do try and only keep the best of the best, and then I take my heads and my tails and put those into my fence jar for future redistillation. I know probably a lot of you guys don't redistill your heads, you just do the tails. And I've had great success with redistilling the heads and the tails together. When I do a heads and tails run, that run always comes out with a real clean taste and usually a higher yield than a regular stripping run. You know, each into their own. Each people like to do things their own way. This is how I do it. And if you haven't done it this way, don't knock it till you try it. Give it a try. Let me know how it works out. Now, the second day of distilling, I used low wines that I had kicking around for months and months and months. They were sitting in the back of my beer closet, and they smelled okay, but I had added soda ash to them sometime long ago, and there was like a slight, almost like a kind of a green, very, very faint green tinge. I mean, it might even have been the color of the glass affecting it, but it looked slightly green, so it looked a tiny bit off. If your low wines are blue, just throw them away and start over. You know, the last thing you want to do is be ingesting copper sulfate somehow. I know it's a salt. I know if you put it in the boiler, it will, you know, stay in the boiler. It won't distill off. But we got to be safe here, guys. If something's like a strange color, something's obviously wrong with the spirits, you know, don't chance it. Dump it down the drain. Start over. It's not the end of the world. Of course, do as I say, not as I do. This was just a little tint of what I thought looked like green, and it smelled fine, so I went ahead and distilled this on my second day. For this run, I settled on pumping in 1,124 watts approximately throughout the entire run. For this run, I used my notes spreadsheet, and it calculates all sorts of fun and exciting things. So it calculates the theoretical percent complete, so you can have an idea of about how far you are through your run. You put your jar size in and how much you're going to be collecting. It tells you when to set an alarm. Calculates the reflux ratio. Records, you know, the temperature, the power setting, all that good stuff. So I'll include a link down below to my blog post where you can see the notes in detail. And if you guys are interested in seeing or using that spreadsheet, let me know. I can do a video specifically on the spreadsheet, how I use it. Obviously, I'm open to suggestions on ways to better improve note taking. So hope you guys like the notes or have some kind of constructive criticism about them. For run number two, we ended up with a yield of about 38%. And that's not great, but I think the, you know, garbage in, garbage out really applies here. If you don't start off with good source material, you're going to end up with a garbage product. So there we have it. The third day of distilling was distilling the combination of all the heads and tails minus the four shots from the previous days. On day three, I really tried to push the output of the still more than day number two. Day number one, I didn't really push it at all. But day number three, I really tried to see at what point would the spirit degrade if I took off the product at a higher rate. What is the limitation of production now that I'm using SPP as opposed to the Scrubbies? And we'll touch on that right after I talk about the notes a little bit. I ended up settling on a power setting of 1220 watts for the entire run. This run, I got a good yield out of it. I got a 65% yield, which I think is fantastic. Please let me know what kind of yields you guys get in the comments down below. Be interested in knowing. Obviously, pushing production in this way, this is going to affect my yields from, you know, the second and third days. But I was happy with the third day yield for sure. After having 3 days of distilling under my belt with the SPP and looking at the notes I took, it looks like the max production that I can do is get about 1.7 liters per hour. And that's of azeotrope. So that's like, what, 95.6% alcohol. I found if I went any faster than that, the taste of the spirit would degrade. I don't know if the alcohol by volume percentage really went down that much, but I could definitely taste the spirit degrade when I pushed the still past that point. My production rates for stainless steel Scrubbies, they were about somewhere in the range of like 1.2 liters per hour. So we do see a fairly significant increase when using SPP over the Scrubbies we all know and love. After crunching all these numbers, I dove into my email archives and I found some original emails from the SPP manufacturer. And it's kind of funny. I forgot that he had told me this, but in his email when I was trying to decide what size of SPP to buy, he said that the size I ended up buying would produce about 1.7 liters an hour of azeotrope on my still. So it's somewhat reassuring and satisfying that my results match what the manufacturer said they would. If I look at all the numbers after 3 days of distilling, it appears I got approximately 32 liters at 40%. That's not too bad in my books. That will keep me warm throughout the winter. For sure, I'm going to be taking some of that vodka. I'm going to be infusing it and making gin with it. So stay tuned for future videos. I'm working on a deconstructed gin right now, where I'm making a juniper, a orange rind, and a coriander extracts, and combining those later, mixing them together, create a gin. If you like that video, please hit that like button. Hit that bell icon and that subscribe button. It really means the world to me. I love you guys very much. I hope you're having a great day.